part of our conversation?
Sure, sure.
Thank you. So just a brief introduction or what I want to say, that everybody know your work on Facebook because you are working very rigorously, like I could say, in a way that trying to create awareness for the heritage. And when CityTales was started, Rami?
CityTales was I started it in June 2019. So June, basically,
but before 13 months. Also, you are sharing a lot on your profile about
yes.
So, as you came from a very different background, a technocrat, and then MBA, and working for a multinational company, such a tough schedule. So, how such this balancing came up, and how such a passion for this work started actually?
Actually, I came to Delhi in December 2015, and उस टाइम पे भी उससे पहले भी आई वॉज ऑलवेज वेरी फॉन्ड ऑफ एक्सप्लोरिंग स्ट्रीट फूड एंड आई वॉज वेन एवर आई यूज टू कम टू डेली आई यूज टू गो टू जामा मस्जिद एरिया सो वेन आई केम सेटल्ड इन डेली इन 2015 डिसम्बर 2014 तो आई स्टार्टेड गोइंग टू जामा मस्जिद एरिया एंड पुरानी दिल्ली स्पेसिफिकली टू सर्च फॉर स्ट्रीट फूड तो कोई ऐसा हेरिटेज और मॉन्यूमेंट्स का ऐसा कोई इंटरेस्ट था नहीं और उसके बाद भी तीन साल फ्रॉम 2015 टू 2017 आई वाज रिग्रेसली लुकिंग फॉर न्यू प्लेसेस ऑफ स्ट्रीट फूड लेजेंडरी स्ट्रीट फूड प्लेसेस विच आर कनेक्टेड टू द कल्चर ऑफ दिल्ली विच आर कनेक्टेड टू द हिस्ट्री ऑफ दिल्ली पोस्ट पार्टीशन कुजींस प्री पार्टीशन कुजींस मुगलई कुजींस आई वाज एक्सप्लोरिंग ऑल दैट और उसी में ही इन द थ्री ईयर्स आई वाज लुकिंग फॉर दीज प्लेसेस ऑफ फूड आई यूज टू पास बाय ऑल दीज ओल्ड मॉस्क्स जैन टेम्पल्स Havelis, Jama Masjid was either way a big giant standing in between in the middle of Shahjahanabad. So I was aware of those places, but ये था कि खाने पे concentration था. But then as time passed and I realized कि I'm missing out on a huge chunk of culture of a cultural heritage by just you know going for food only all the time. So in 2017 end after getting bored by all these food spots. And also motivated in part by explorations and write-ups of people like Rana Safi ma'am, Swapna Little ma'am, Suhail Hashmi saab, who I used to follow on social media. I just one day I just decided to go to Red Fort. It was New Year of 2018. And before that, मिखासे में 2018 जनवरी से पहले Red Fort एक बार गया था और ताजमहल एक बार गया था. उसके अलावा मैं कुछ और घूमा नहीं था. एंड देन बस वो रेड फोर्ट गया वहाँ पे घूमा चार पांच घंटे एंड इट्स जस्ट क्लिक्ड कि देयर इज सो मच टू आवर हेरिटेज मोर देन व्हाट मीट्स द आई इवन रेड फोर्ट इन इटसेल्फ हैड सो मेनी मॉन्यूमेंट्स व्हिच नोबडी यूज्ड टू टॉक अबाउट देन नेक्स्ट वीक आई स्टार्टेड गोइंग टू अदर फेमस स्पॉट्स उन फेमस स्पॉट्स पे जाके उनके लेस फेमस स्पॉट्स के बारे में पता चला आई बॉट अ लॉट ऑफ बुक्स and eventually just it just you know expanded from there and from 2018 to May 2019 I explored a lot and I was sharing them on my Facebook profile itself but in by May and I realized that I needed to make it more organized and make it and bring the content to one place and hence the idea of City Tales came to me and I started it in end of May 2019 And from there, it has just grown really good, thankfully.
So Kunal bhai, aa gaye hain. Kunal bhai, connect nahi ho raha tha. Oh, I was understanding there was some issue. Yes, yes, that's why.
मैंने laptop change किया है फिर.
So that's why.
Yes, बढ़िया.
It is Ramin because we gave the time. Kunal bhai, meanwhile, you can share it on from your phone on your profile because people who are connected with you are able to see you. Might be they are not able to know about our page. So just from the page, you can share it. So Ramin, in this way, the journey goes on.
Yeah.
And so from 2019, the City Tales came in and that's a great achievement. I could say that adding a lot of explorations in length and breadth from a different parts of our country. And not only from Delhi, mainstream heritage but the idea of this talk came up with you and Kunal bhai when both of us came in that Kunal bhai was working in one of his region and you covered a lot of heritage but mainstream but also lesser known heritage So this was the idea. So Kunal bhai, let's start with your introduction. As you also completed your engineering and then you shifted to journalism, and from journalism as a passion you started this work. So how does this Save Patna Collectorate campaign, now considered as a movement, as you told me, that how does this journey started and how you moved to this step?
Well, I would say the very first impulse that in a way inspired me to start something is that when I was growing up, the idea of my city, you know, it was never a very wholesome idea about what my city was. So when I finished my engineering, even when I was doing my engineering in Gujarat, you know, at the Dhirubhai Ambani Institute of Information and Communication Technology, people would always, in a way, you know, I remember people telling me that aapke Patna mein kya hai, you know, and the typical stereotypes, you don't look like you're from Patna, you know, you don't sound like you're from Patna, you know, what is this, you know, this, you know, few days back we had a guest from Google, you know, she's from Patna, and she says she got the same questions in US, despite going to Harvard. And she told something very that struck me. She said, the identity of Bihar has been defined by others because Bihar itself has not defined its identity. So what you see in movies is, you know, ek rickshaw wala, ek uncultured Bihari, baat karne nahi aa raha. It's only because we have not been able to project our own strength. And as Ramin bhai also would agree, you know, when we discussed about the lesser known heritage for that matter. And Patna ki aap baat agar karte hain, you only tend to talk about the ancient glorification of Pataliputra. So this was all going in my head, you know, all this while I was working in Bangalore as an engineer, this was also weighing at the back of my mind. So a couple of years after there, you know, I decided to come back with my savings. I didn't tell my parents, I quit my job. I came back and I started a project to document my city. This is, I'm talking about way back in 2008-09. And this is how I would say the seeds were germinated, you know, that's the beginning of it. And when I was doing this documentation, suddenly I realized that around 2010, there was this wave of demolition that started. One by one, we started losing everything. So I basically put my documentation project on hold and converted it into something I thought which needed a larger platform where everybody who is concerned about heritage, and not just, when I say everybody, I include people like both of you, you know, who have no direct connection with Patna, but they feel the same pain. They understand what it means to lose a heritage. They understand what it means to have a heritage in a city. You know, you ask people who live in Noida, and you know, if you ask them to name five places, they will start with GIP Mall and all. So, I mean, when children will grow up in such cities, what is the kind of, you know, cultural impression they're going to grow up with? And this was something that was bothering me. You know, ki Patna ka jo future hai, the future of Patna that we're talking about, are we going to bequeath to our future generation a legacy which is so diminished, which is so fraught with losses, that, you know, tomorrow we will be asked if somebody. And that was the second impulse for me, that to save something for the future. And when in 2016, of course, between 2010, the Bankipur Central Jail got demolished, and 2016, you have a 7-year period in which we lost innumerable heritage, including, of course, the house of Charles Doyle, Sir Charles Doyle, which was, you know, I mean, and Ramin was shocked when he got to know last time that,
yes, one of the renowned painters.
Yeah, very renowned.
He's celebrated in London, he's celebrated in European museums and art galleries, and here in Patna, where he actually started something called the Bihar School of Athens. He patronized local artists. He asked them to do artwork. He himself was an OPM agent, but I mean, a sort of a bureaucrat. But he himself was doing sketching. He would go to Gaya, he would go to other regions, to Bhojpur and to other regions of Bihar, and he would actually do his sketching. I mean, today it's unimaginable for a bureaucrat to go outside, and I know a lot of them are doing it. You know, I said it, but again, they are the exceptions now. And when I read British accounts and I see so many bureaucrats and civil servants actually documenting themselves, not just asking someone or commissioning a work. So this was a third impulse to actually document something. And fourth was, there was absolutely no local laws to prevent demolition. We looked into that there was no heritage commission. There was no laws which would prevent. And ASI was saying, we have too much on our plate. State archaeology will say, they are preserving something which is already well preserved, and then something which is too much fraught with risk. You're not even notifying that building as protected. So we thought we as a community, we as people, especially the youth of Patna, whether we live in Patna, whether we live outside of Bihar, or whether we live outside of India. In fact, you will be pleased to know that the majority of our support actually comes from outside of India, and a lot of them are NRI. A lot of them have the roots in Patna, and they are very, very well connected to the roots. And I think I was wrong in assuming that when you become an NRI, you sort of become completely disconnected. I think you become more, you yourself are an NRI. You know, I think you are more connected to your Pilibhit than perhaps a person living in Pilibhit. And so all these factors, and the fact that before 2016, we were unable to prevent such moves of demolition, we realized we needed a formal platform to start something. And that's how on April 3, 2016, I just signed up a Facebook page and I called it Save Historic Patna Collection. You know, and the name was chosen very consciously, because many people said, "Aap isko Save Bihar kar dijiye, make it a broad-based campaign." And I said, "No, we wanted to start and make it a very focused campaign. We also wanted to make sure that this campaign will become a pivot around which people will revolve and remember this building. That, you know, this is the building which inspired us to come together." And in a way, collected also means collection, you know, so it's a collection of heritage lovers. So that's how the journey began. And it was essentially to bring together like-minded people who care for heritage, who can contribute for preservation of heritage, including government officials. And we are not enemy of the government. We always say this. We want to be the friends of the government. And we pleaded to them for 3 to 4 years. And, you don't listen to us.
So this is how Save Patna Collectorate movement was started. Thank you, Kunal Bhai. So now let us take some two visual stories from Haryana by Ramin, and then we will go to Kunal Bhai to take some stories. So alternatively, we will switch with two stories, both of you. The idea behind it today, why we came up while discussing the journey of City Tales and Kunal Bhai's movement, Save Patna Collectorate. And in between, we just want to show that there's a lot of work what both of them are doing. But just to signify, or just to show them to our reader, to our audiences here, or today those who are participating with us or joining with us, just to see the situation of the heritage, how much difficult it is to preserve it in one way or other way. So just to share with the documentation. So Ramin, can we start with Haryana?
Yeah, and sure.
Let me share the screen here. Okay. And start with the picture which we use it here on our flyer. This picture speaks a lot. So
yes.
I mean, can you say something on this?
Sure. So ek to pehle Haryana ka thoda sa context main bata dun. So Haryana as a state has a lot of this lost heritage or hidden heritage jiski hum baat karte hain, because this state there are three reasons to it. Ek to because of partition, the demography of Haryana changed dramatically. Muslims from Haryana moved to Pakistan, and people from Pakistan moved to Haryana and Punjab. So there are a lot of these monuments which Muslims left behind, which were abandoned, and these tombs, these mosques. So they were abandoned, and also secondly, Haryana doesn't have these places like Delhi, a place like Hampi, a place like say Gaya in Bihar, which is like which has a lot of media attention on it. It doesn't have a World Heritage City to its name, at least not what I'm aware of. So basically, there is no media attention to the heritage of Haryana, most of the heritage of Haryana. And thirdly, because there are many districts of Haryana which are economically facing a lot of challenges, so people really don't care, the locals really didn't care about the heritage so much. Many of the locals don't care about the heritage. So Haryana is like this hub of hidden, lost, heritage that we are losing every day. Coming to this picture, belongs to a place called Taudu, and Taudu is a small town in the district of Mewat. It comes under the tehsil of Nuh. So the history of the region has in itself been very interesting. The Mewatis have been traditionally been very independent minded and very rebellious and very at odds with the authority in Delhi. They have been, you know, pain in the neck of the Delhi Sultanate, the Mughals. So this place has always had its very interesting stories to its name. So Tavdu, according to a 1828 gazetteer, was called Lesser Balochistan because they were
interesting.
Because people from Balochistan moved to this place during the Lodi era, and the chieftain for this region was also a Balochi. So this is the background of Tavdu. This tomb complex has around 8 tombs to its name, and it is a kind of tomb complex which I am damn sure we can't find in a place like Delhi, which has like thousands of more than 500 monuments, because this tomb complex has monuments dating from Tughlaq era, Lodi era, and Mughal era. All three eras in the same 1.5 acre complex, belonging to the same, probably to the successive generations of the same family, who were Balochis. So basically, the major tomb of this tomb complex belongs to the Balochi chieftain of Tavdu. And all these other tombs also belong to family members of his who came down the ages. Now this pic is very interesting because you can see gobar ke cake jo hai yahan pe garam kiye ja rahe hain, dry kiye ja rahe hain.
Yes, cow dung cakes has been dried out in the lawns.
So interestingly, out of these 8 tombs, 2 have been preserved by intact, but the remaining 6 are in terrible position. The locals use these tombs to dry their gobar cakes. They are used for spending time in matlab getting garmi mein andar baith ke thandak lene ke liye use hota hai, sone ke liye use hota hai. Jo original graves hai, they have been lost to time. Their cracks pad chuke hain inme, kahin pe koi kuch chhat dheh gayi hai, kahin pe kuch diwar ka ek section dheh gaya hai. There is a 200-year-old well also in this tomb complex. There is a wall mosque also in this tomb complex. So basically, there are 10 monuments in this 1 acre complex in a small town of Tavdu, and which in fact has more history and more types of history than a lot of other heritage spots that which are much more famous and are more talked about. But nobody talks about it. It's just being withering away to time.
So Ramin, thank you for sharing this wonderful, or what we say now, in not a good condition, at least it's a pathetic state, but some remnants are still there. And interesting Balochistan connection. This is really first time I get to know that very closely a living Balochistan connection existed here.
Yes.
And can we move to the next story? This interesting blackboard. You can see that there is some teaching and learning going on.
These
are there, calligraphy is there, two blackboard has been installed. So this place is there exactly in Tarau or some other location in Haryana?
So basically there is this small town called Sohna, and people who work in Gurgaon know it because Sohna Road pe sabse zyada corporate offices hain. So Sohna Road is very famous in Gurgaon and many people work there. So Sohna in itself is a treasure trove of heritage. Now Sohna was ruled by successive generations of Khanzada Rajputs, then Sisodia Rajputs, then Jats, then it had French influence, then it had British influence. So Sohna in itself, it's a very small town, has around 20 different monuments. Usme 10 to tombs hain, all of which are abandoned and all of which are used for different functional purposes. Jaise wahan pe गाय भैंसे बांधी जाती हैं, वहां पे कूड़ा डाला जाता है, वो वहां पे चारपाई लगा के सोते हैं, या बस ऐसी छोड़ रखा है. उसके अलावा देर आर 3-4 मॉस, जिसमें से सिर्फ ओनली वन इज लिविंग एंड अदर रेस्ट आर ऑल अबैंडेंड. उसके अलावा सोना हैज हॉट वाटर स्प्रिंग्स विच डेट फ्रॉम 1647 एंड दे आर कॉल्ड शिव कुंड एंड पिलग्रिम्स कम फ्रॉम ऑल ओवर द प्लेस टू सोना for pilgrimage to these Shiv Kunds, and these are natural hot water springs. But this pic belongs to a place called Najmul Haq Dargah Complex. Now Najmul Haq ke baare mein there is not much information. Oral history comes from an imam of Jama Masjid of Faridabad who told me, who belonged to Mewat, and who told me that Najmul Haq somehow was related to Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan, according to him.
Means his ancestor or some much before than him, related to his ancestors or
his related to his ancestors. And Sayyid Ahmad Khan even visited Sona during his lifetime to look to visit Najmul Haq Dargah. But this is just oral history. I have not found written proof of it. So Najmul Haq Dargah has a gateway, a tomb, and this mosque. So currently Najmul Haq Dargah has become a school, a government paathshala. It has become.
It's a typical paathshala.
And yes. Locals call it Masjid School. They call it by the name Masjid School. So gateway hai Najmul Haq Dargah ka. So this dargah belongs to 16th century. Kuch documentation.
Calligraphy, motifs, and all these things, the use of the material. It shows that belong to Lodi era or
Lodi, probably Lodi. Later Lodi or Lodi, definitely Lodi. So 15th century hai mostly. Documentation nahi hai ki kab ka hai. So jo uska jo domed gateway hai, it has become the staff room of the teachers.
Okay.
उसके बाद जो नजमुल हक साहब की मरहूम नजमुल हक साहब की जो दरगाह थी जो टूम थी इट हैज बिकम द कैंटीन ऑफ द स्टूडेंट्स वहां पे खाने का सामान बिकता है एंड द मॉस्क दिस ब्यूटीफुल मॉस्क विच हैज मतलब विच इज ऑल ऑफ इट्स वॉल्स आर कवर्ड विद इस्लामिक कैलीग्राफी एंड इट हैज दीज ब्यूटीफुल पिलर्स जिनकी कैपिटल्स पे ब्यूटीफुल ऑर्नामेंटेशन है रेड स्टोन रेड एंड येलो सैंड स्टोन का काम है. This is the actual paathshala of the students, and it is so interesting. ये जो mihrab है मतलब जिसपे worship namazis used to worship offer namaz in its direction. यहाँ पे blackboard लग गए यहाँ पे teaching होती है school की.
This is west facing wall I think.
This is the main wall of the mosque जिसपे ये mihrab है जहाँ पे namazis namaz पढ़ा करते होंगे एक time पे. तो this has become the paathshala actual paathshala. तो ये पूरे mosque तो पूरे मॉस्क के अंदर बस बेंचेस पड़े हुए हैं जहाँ पे बच्चे बैठ के पढ़ते हैं और ये ब्लैक बोर्ड लगे हुए हैं. बट थैंकफुली ये कैलीग्राफी जो है प्रिजर्व्ड है तो जिसको मैंने काफी कुछ डॉक्यूमेंट कर लिया है. तो मतलब ये सैड स्टोरी है हरियाणा की विच आई हैव रिप्रेजेंटेड बाय दीज टू इमेजेस.
सो नाउ कैन वी कम टू कुणाल भाई. सो कुणाल भाई आर यू एबल टू लिसन अस.
या
कुणाल भाई लेट्स स्टार्ट विद योर विजुअल्स. सो 1 मिनट let me share the screen and then yes Kunal bhai let's go back. We will take 2 stories first from Patna then we'll come. So here is a picture Kunal bhai that's showing some colonial monument and it's you have written it here at the top Patna collectorate historic yet condemned. So can you please share some stories of this monument.
What you see in front of you, I don't know. I just want to do a just quick snap poll. Just 2 of the samples here, Ramin Bhai and Rayan Bhai. You know, when you see this building, what are the thoughts that come into your head? Just both of you tell me. Just immediately, right? Ramin Bhai, you can tell it first.
Yeah, Ramin, you want to share some thoughts on this picture?
मुझे तो पता ही है क्या है. मतलब मैं I will be biased. रियान भाई आप बताओ मुझे तो पता ही नहीं है क्या.
या इट सीम्स टू बी अ ग्रैंड मॉन्यूमेंट ऑफ इट्स टाइम एंड यू सी दैट देयर इज सम पीपल आर ड्वेलिंग इनसाइड इट देयर इज सम ऑक्यूपेशन द क्लोथ्स आर ड्राइंग ऑन वन साइड एंड ऑन द लेफ्ट एंड द राइट फ्रंट कॉलम्स आर बैडली आई थिंक दे हैव डन सम ऑफ द आर्ट वर्क और दे हैव डैमेज्ड द पार्ट ऑफ इट कलर्स. सो दिस सम सॉर्ट ऑफ डिटोरिएशन आई कैन सी ऑन इट्स फ्लैंक्स.
Yes, and Ramin bhai, even though I know you know about it and we have talked at length about it, but I still want to hear your immediate thought after seeing this facade. You know, what is your immediate thought?
मतलब ऐसा लग रहा है कि जैसे कुछ किसी को कुछ मतलब it has been conveniently forgotten and ठीक है जैसे भी है कपड़े सूख रहे हैं वहाँ पे कूड़ा करकट पड़ा हुआ दिख रहा है. तो मतलब ऐसा है कि भाई it's like an eyesore for people कि भैया चलो कुछ इसे छोड़ दो ये अपने हाल पे छोड़ दो. कुछ मेंटेनेंस नहीं है. इट्स जस्ट मतलब इट्स अ सैड सैड यू कैन टेल एंड सी कि इट्स अ कॉलोनियल मॉन्यूमेंट एंड बाय द पिलर्स इटसेल्फ बट यू कैन आल्सो टेल एंड सी कि इट्स एन आईसोर फॉर अ लॉट ऑफ पीपल बिकॉज देयर इज नो केयर टेकिंग ऑफ दिस मॉन्यूमेंट.
बट नाउ टेल मी द रीजन आई आस्क यू दिस टू क्वेश्चंस इज व्हेन समवन हु हैज नेवर बीन टू पटना और व्हेन द यूथ ऑफ पटना हु ओनली गोस टू दिस ग्लिट्ज़ी मॉल्स where everything shines, where everything has just shining fountains and gardens and flowers and everything. Now, if that person goes to this place, you know, for getting the affidavit done, now, do you expect that person to really have that sense, that sensitivity, that sense of understanding of this? Just honestly tell me.
Absolutely not. It to coverage hai nahi, plus
there is no exposure. This building has been kept. You know, I always call that this is the grand dame of Patna. She's a beautiful woman of Patna who has been kept in such a disheveled condition with her hair, you know, not washed for months, for years, and you know, the face is completely covered in dark soot. And you, I'm trying to tell everybody that she's a beautiful woman. Try to see it. I said, "Aap kya bol rahe hain? Ye to bahut badsurat hai saamne khadi hai mere saamne. Aap kyun baar-baar keh rahe hain? Hataiye isko hamari nazaron ke saamne se." So the point is that we try to show her beauty through a cafe. Then, you know, through, we use the power of technology, we use the power of imagination. So that was a tangent I want to draw, but I now want to come back to why I chose this particular building. So this is the oldest building of the Patna Collectorate. Now, Patna Collectorate, as the name suggests, you know, all the collected buildings in India are very historic buildings. And most of them, I would dare say, most of them belong to colonial era, British period to be exact. But this particular collectorate has a Dutch history. I mean, I have not come across any collectorate in India so far, you know, which have been documented or reported, which has a Dutch connection, which has a building that was built by the Dutch East India Company. As per the document, and Ramin Bhai has that book now, it is said that 1638 is when the first Dutch trading post, first Dutch trading post was made. And this particular building is said to be part of it. So this is the record room. And by the way, the film Gandhi was shot in that particular, the Motihari's jail scene was shot. So we thought that this is one particular building that even I grew up in Patna, I did not know that Gandhi film was shot there. It is when I found the connection in 2013 and reported about it. The second building is, I don't know how many of you know, this particular column style is called the pilaster column. And of course, I'm very sure in Patna, there is no other building which has this style of column. This is called the pilaster column. And this is inside the meeting hall of the district board Patna, which is part of the Patna Collectorate campus. So Patna Collectorate has two Dutch buildings, two major British buildings. So this is the record room, currently used as the record room. And on the right hand side, I wish I had the picture, the columns have been completely cemented. You know, they have made a small room out of it. Can you imagine? They have made a small room out of that entire historic building. And the second building is the district board Patna, which was built in 1938. I know the year because on the top of it, they used to have the marker of 1938. But that, when you can actually see the roof has been removed. You know, it has been deliberately
removed. Yes, it has been able to locate in the picture that roof has been removed. Yeah. So exactly when, up to which stage it was in use or it was used by the government, or up to which stage, when it was abandoned actually?
It is. I wouldn't agree with you. It has never been abandoned. The first picture that you showed, Rehan Bhai.
Yes.
This building right now, there's an office running, and till today, as we speak, there must be some work going on in this building right now. As we speak.
Still, it holds the office.
It's the district collector's record room right now.
Right now it's a record room. Okay.
So people are working inside it. They're sitting inside it. They actually, it's a living building. It's not a dead or abandoned heritage. It's actually a living heritage. It's one of the living heritage of Patna. It is more living than the secretariat. It is more living than the Patna Museum, which nobody goes to after 5 p.m. You know, nobody goes to Patna Museum. And this particular building was so beautifully used. You know, I wish I could have shared that picture also. Maybe I'll share it later. 2016, I took a picture of this building, the year the demolition was proposed. And these columns that you see, they were blue, shining blue. They were shining blue. And now you can see with the rain and with all the dust and everything, it is now exposed.
So that's already, it's completely crumbled. The roof has been completely crumbled. So can we come to the next picture? What is this exactly? Gold market.
Yes, gold market, British made gold market almost everywhere. In Delhi, you know there's a gold market. Ramin Bhai knows that.
In
Bengali market, there's a gold market.
Near Connaught Place.
Because of the round. Yeah, actually gold market is called mini CP.
Because it's a bit like that.
Yeah. And this gold market was built around the same time when between 1912 and 1915, I would say, when the new Patna was coming up. You know, unlike New Delhi, New Patna, nobody knows, because there was a similar, after Delhi Darbar of 1911, when New Delhi was made, I would like to share with people that New Delhi was not the name given in 1912. If that name came in 1926, it was the new imperial capital of the British Raj. So similarly, when they made the Bihar and Odisha as a separate province, and they carved it out of Bengal and made Patna as the joint capital, so similar planning was being done. So they created this market. It was Bihar's first municipal market. It was Patna's first municipal market. And it was designed by the same architect who designed New Patna, which Joseph Fieris Munning. He designed High Court, he designed the Raj Bhavan, he did the government house of the Bihar government, and he designed along with Millwood, A.M. Millwood, the assembly building. So this building was roughly around 112 year old when they very brutally, in broad daylight, it was demolished. And we had met the then municipal commissioner. We had also told that, this is a iconic building. I showed him the original plan. I told him this is part of the original plan of 1912, and he knew about it. He was surprised that it was such a historic building. And
so when this demolition was started, Kunal bhai, and what was the
so this was in, I met him in the month of May when I had gone to cover the elections and cast my vote. So after doing that, I met him, and then when I came back, a good friend from Patna, actually the gentleman who wrote this book called Patna Ek Khoya Hua Shahar, and there is a chapter in it actually about this market. It talks about the fact that when this market was there, there were gardens around it, and with Lahori bricks and all the hoi polloi, and the elite of Patna, they would go to do shopping here. And it was designed in a hexagonal central court, and it had two elongated corridors. So you have you had chicken market, you had mutton market, you had the egg market. Everything was done so separately and very beautifully. Now, this is all that is left of it. I found it in the month of, around the June time, when they demolished it. So I had gone, there was a death in my family, so I had gone for that. And then when I found out that this is all that was left of it. So we as a society, we have failed, and it was told to us that it was demolished because it was coming in the middle of the smart city project. How smart we are, Rehan bhai. You can see how smart we are.
So this is how we need to coexist with our past and present in a meaningful manner, and that can make a contextual to all of us. Definitely, they cannot leave it, because we have a very high density of population. We need to manage our spaces, but make a meaningful connection with our past. Connection with the present.
I must say that we had presented we were making a cafe plan for this building also, like the collectorate. We felt sort of cheated.
Yeah, always there are a lot of interest and a lot of vested interest due to a huge demand of money and capital generated behind these big, huge spaces. So, Ramin, can we come up to your side? Now we covered Haryana. And we covered beautifully. Kunal bhai gave us an idea about the pathetic state of colonial heritage. That was Patna as a very old connection with British. One of the earliest connection of British during the days of East India Company, it was started. North India connection generated much later. So let's come back to your area. So we are now moving towards Delhi. There is one very beautiful monument. Ramin has bring it from Delhi. So let me share my screen. And this is, yes.
So people know about Vasant Vihar. Vasant Vihar is in South Delhi. In Vasant Vihar, there is a section which gives into Aravali Biodiversity Park. And it's all densely wooded green area. In that area, there is a place called Muradabad Pahadi. Now, Muradabad Pahadi has no connection with the Muradabad of Uttar Pradesh. Muradabad Pahadi is named after Hazrat Murad Ali Shah Baba, who came to these jungles in the reign of Tughlaqs. He made this area his retreat. He started praying here. He attracted a lot of followers. And he died here. He died here in 1331, and his pavilion tomb exists nearby. and because his influence was very far reaching, there were a lot of people coming here. There is a massive Bauli behind his pavilion tomb, and that Bauli is supposedly the largest Bauli of Delhi, and that Bauli has been just lost to time and just covered by just vegetation and everything, and it has been just lost. Now coming to these monuments which you can see in these pics, so because people were coming to Murad Ali Shah Babad for his blessings, and after he passed away also, probably these mosques were built for the people who were coming to pay their respects to the Sufi saint. Now what's interesting about these mosques, you can see the left mosque has a hemispherical dome and a different architecture from the right mosque. Yes. So what has happened is that these are two mosques which belong to two different eras of Delhi Sultanate. So the left mosque, it's called Kasai Wala Gumbad, and it has a hemispherical dome, and it belongs to Tughlaq era, probably to the era of Firoz Shah Tughlaq. Yes. And the right mosque belongs to the and has this beautifully tapered dome and a lotus kalash on top, and it's called Shahi Masjid, and it belongs to the Lodi era. So we have two different eras being represented in the same pic, and these, in fact, they are like two conjoined twins, which are almost more than a century apart.
But so I think both of them are in use, so they have whitewashed it, and they have their heritage essence has been partly lost, but still it is. Yes.
Actually, a madrasa runs from here, which is called Madrasa Abdul Manan Academy. And Mr. Abdul Manan belonged to Mewat, and he came to this region and he made it his home, and he started a madrasa in these mosques, and his son Maulana Rashid runs it right now. So this place is restricted right now. Not everyone can go inside. Only namazis from nearby expats can come here for Friday namaz, and locals come and pay their respect at the gate of this area. To Haji Murad Ali Shah Baba. So it's a unique monument which has Lodi and Tughlaq era mosque attached to each other.
Thank you, Ramin.
The color, doesn't look like the heritage nature has been sort of compromised.
No? Yeah, no, definitely. Yes, what do you think, Ramin?
No, actually, so basically it is pure whitewashing done by the people who are living in it.
On stone.
So basically they have not done it from perspective of heritage. So that's the sad story of Delhi. Wherever monuments are alive and functioning, and if they come under control of Waqf, there is a problem of maintaining the heritage character of the monument. So there is this balance which has to be maintained between the heritage character and keeping the monument alive at the same time.
Okay, so Kunal bhai, let's go back to your part, and some other monuments you have bring it here for the discussion. And, so let me so can you little bit explain about these visuals from Madhubani?
Madhubani, everybody knows, I think both of you are well acquainted with the Madhubani style of painting or the Mithila style of painting, right?
Yes.
Every one of you are well acquainted. The world is well acquainted. But how many of them would know that in the same Madhubani region, which is now a separate district, it was part of the Darbhanga district, the cultural heart of India, in that sense, because it's that beautiful. You have to actually go, and people like Ramin will just get lost there. I started crying when I went there first time. How can a society which calls itself so civilized can let its heritage be so savage? And this is in the Madhubani district. The place is called Rajnagar. And mm-hmm. the interesting story is that this particular Rajnagar place was built as the capital of the Darbhanga Raj. The brother of
Raja of Darbhanga.
The brother of Lakshmeshwar Singh. When after him, it was his brother Sir Rameshwar Singh who made this, who commissioned this palace. And it is said that Mr. D.A. Corney was the architect of this particular building. There's a marble plaque somewhere embedded onto it, but there is no conclusive evidence as to. I've been trying for years and decades to find out who was the architect.
So what was the exact date of building this palace?
Yes, so it is said that it was built somewhere in the late, the work started, it took a lot of time, late 1880s, so late 19th century and early 20th century it was completed. But the tragedy of this place is that, you know, soon after its completion, the 1934, the great Bihar-Nepal earthquake of 1934, it just wrecked through it. You know, this, it was like a, you know, it's someone's wedding and there is a massacre. You know, it was like that. You know, I'm going to show you. Ramin has not seen that picture. You will, your eyes will start, you know, coming to tears. You know, that, just take to the last photo, Rehan bhai. After this, yes, look at it, Ramin bhai. No, before that.
So this was a photo when it was built.
Yeah, this is somewhere around 1935. Yeah, and people believe this was in Bihar. It was a place in, I mean, it beats Europe. You know, you won't believe that this palace was a toast of the town in London. People would talk about this. Wow. And today, Bihari people don't know about it. You know, people of Bihar, they go to Europe, they start taking selfies, but they don't know what they're losing. Today, now go back to the second picture, sir. That is the other beautiful story. Second, sir, second picture.
Before that, Rehan bhai, yes.
Yeah, this one. Yes, now, the other peculiar story of this monument, or rather this palace, the palatial ruins, is called the ruins of Rajnagar, actually, still called the ruins of Rajnagar. And my journey, in a way, for love for heritage began with this building. I mean, if I may just dwell upon 1 minute, in Patna, I went to a magazine corner, and there was a magazine there called Mithila Darpan. You know, it was hung up on the wire. And I just immediately spotted this picture. And I said, they told me this is somewhere in Madhubani. And this is how I fell in love with it, this building. And these two elephants, actually, there are two elephants behind it.
One, yes.
These two horizontal, and there are two vertical, you know, there. You can see here in this Ramin bhai.
So yes, yeah.
It is said that it was the very first time, it is claimed, we don't know, there's no proof. It is said that it is for the first time that cement was used in India. That's, you know, building cement was, we were not using cement, we were using Surkhi Chuna, right? But these elephants were built out of cement. So this is the another peculiarity of this building. And of course, there are a whole host of temples which have got beautiful carvings on inside of them, in the pavilion, in the courtyards. And this whole area could be transformed into a magical spot. And I even when the Madhubani Literature Festival happened, they actually made a stage in front of this building and they covered the building, you know. The stage made a backdrop that covered the monument. So what kind of pride is this, you know?
We can see the reflection or the mix of British architecture and Bengali, or the typical Indian architecture, mixed blend of both architectures.
I think it's European and Indo-Saracenic mix.
Typical blend of Indian and architecture. It's a beautiful building.
And I mean, people like Ramin will knock himself out. You know, you will not beautiful. Want to come out of this. Beautiful. And this is what you can see. What is remained of it? Of course, taken from the Dabhanga archives.
Really, this sort of building can be restored from the tourism point of view, and the high stakeholders of the heritage caretakers can do this work.
Yeah.
And maybe this sort of awareness, or the movements what you have started, or the work you have done, maybe this will create a sort of awareness that can make some positive changes. And probably this sort of restoration can be done for generating a local tourism, and even the tourists from outside can also be come up with such a beautiful monument.
And exactly, Rehan, when you ask me that, you know, why this is this a campaign, is this a movement? So we our campaign very smoothly transitioned into a movement, because we realized that, of course, our immediate fight was to save something which is in ICU, right? You try to save a person who is dying in I mean, today we talk
so about... It needs a resuscitation or work that can
happen. You try to help someone who is on ventilator right now on COVID. You know, then you take care of the asymptomatic cases. These are your asymptomatic cases. Nobody's touching them. You know, there's no wrecking ball lying over it. I had a tough time explaining to people ki nahi, aap hume Darbhanga ke liye kijiye to hum madad karenge aapko. Aap humare Munger ke liye kijiye to hum... Humne kaha ki this is not about one building or one city. It's a symbolic fight. We are trying to bring people together with one spirit, that this is your city, this is your state, your heritage. You know, don't try to label it that this is not mine, colonial is theirs, It was so, by our hands. You know, it was
in the same way. Hands. In the same way, now we bring two visual stories from Uttar Pradesh. We are coming. This is the last two stories by Ramin. Then we will come on the Hardingale Library or Hardingale Library that you have presented it at the end from Delhi. So you can see the pathetic situation coming right from Uttar Pradesh. Urban sprawling and lot of neglect. So Ramin, can I show?
Yeah, please, please.
So we'll start from this beautiful Carmen.
Yes.
Beautiful carving, amazing architecture, and you have taken a very wonderful perspective in a picture showing the two coexistence of two ages together. Urban sprawl high rise, like in which we used to live. My flat is also some sort of this arrangement with 14-15 floor. So this is something, a real, what we say, the situation of NCR.
Actually.
And you can see the medieval monument. Yes, Ramin, can you please?
So basically, agar bina bataye kisi se, if you will ask ki where are these monuments, nobody can guess it. Ki these beautiful tombs are situated in Ghaziabad, a city which people actually don't talk about heritage at all of that. Ghaziabad has a history going back to 18th century. It was established by the same family who were the Nizams of Hyderabad, and it was called Ghaziuddin Nagar. It had a sarai. It still has two massive gates which still exist and about which I've talked about. Now these tombs, there is this small village called Makanpur in Ghaziabad. And Makanpur must have been a bigger village at one point of time. Today it's a very small village. Behind in this image you can see that's the Amrapali society, massive buildings of Amrapali society, and adjacent to it we have the Makanpur village, which has a very small population, and Makanpur village has a small graveyard. This graveyard used to be a massive graveyard once upon a time, and it used to be a walled graveyard. All of that has been lost to time, and these three pavilion tombs, they probably belong to late Lodi era or early Mughal era, and you can see the beautiful red sandstone work. You can see tiles here. You can see jali work here. You can see these beautiful pillar capitals. There is no written documentation, no written history of who these tombs belong to. The oral history tells us that. I have been hearing this story from my childhood. That when Humayun lost to Sher Shah Suri in the Battle of Chausa and was running away from him, his horse drowned in a river, and there was this Bhishti or a Sakka who was called Nizam, who saved his life by deflating his animal skin so that Humayun can pass the raging river. And what Humayun did was as a thank you to saving his life, he made him emperor for a day. This is a story which has, I don't know how much true is this story and what level this story is true about. The locals believe that these tombs belong to the family of that Nizam Sakka, Nizam Bhishti. That the Battle of Chausa took place somewhere near Banaras, and he was a local from that spot. So it's highly unlikely that these tombs belong to his family. But these beautiful tombs, there is no written documentation of it. They are not on the watch list of ASI, and the locals, there is a Nawab. I met a senior personality called Nawab, and who is very well respected in the village. So his family has been taking care of these tombs on their own. There is nobody taking care of these tombs, and you can see there is Amrapali society behind it. Yeah. Probably the locals would see those tombs and they would also have no idea, and they wouldn't be caring about these tombs. And they are beautiful from inside. Their tile work is falling from a lot of places. The graves are there in some places. The graves are lost in some places. And it's just lying there neglected and lost in time, and nobody's caring about them.
So Ramin, can we move to the last one?
Yes.
This gate also has an interesting story. And just Kunal Bhai, this is from Lucknow.
Yes.
And can see the mix of Indo-Saracenic or some sort of monument. Ramin, can you explain the dates and
Butler Palace? Yes. Yes. So again, like the last image, also you can see an amalgamation of an urban sprawl behind colonial slash Rajput Indo-Saryanisic architecture in front. So this gateway belongs to Butler Palace. So Butler Palace was built by Raja of Mahmudabad for the deputy commissioner of Awadh, Sir Harcourt Butler, so that he could live there. And Butler Palace used to serve as his office, as his residence, as well as an office. And it was built in 1915. So it's one of those unique buildings of Lucknow which has this Rajput and Mughal sort of mix of architecture. It has these chhatris, it has these cusped arches. You don't find much architecture like this in Lucknow. There's very limited architecture like this in Lucknow. So coming back to the story, Raja of Mahmudabad went on, this area belonged to Raja of Mahmudabad. He wanted to make a bigger palace for Harcourt Butler, but in 1921 there was a flood in Gomti. So those plans were left alone. So there was this palace existing for the deputy commissioner, which the area belonged to Raja of Mahmudabad. In 1947, he migrated to Pakistan. So and Britishers left. So this became a place where politicians used to stay, the Butler Palace. Then after 1965 war came the Enemy Property Act, in which people who left for Pakistan, their properties were seized by the government of India as enemy properties. So Butler Palace was a part of it, and it came under the aegis of Indian government. So after that, it served as sales tax office, as a library. In between, the current Raja of Mahmudabad, whoever the Raja of Mahmudabad in 1960s, he put a case in Supreme Court or High Court to get back his property. And there was a whole case going on from 1965 to 1970s to 2005, and for this property. And actually in 2005 he won the case and got this property back. But then again in 2010 Supreme Court took it back from him because the Enemy Property Act rules were revised by some ordinance. So in 2010 this monument became abandoned. And what happened was that Butler Palace was totally abandoned, and this gateway, which was the gateway of Butler Palace, I live near this place. I live walking distance from this place. So I've seen this multi-story monument come in front of my eyes. So this gate, which used to lead to Butler Palace, does not lead to Butler Palace anymore, because this urban massive multi-structured monument has come. So it looks like in this pic that this gateway is actually leading to this monument, this multi-storied modern structure, concrete structure. And this gateway, if you can just zoom it, you can even see ki yahan pe Videocon ki dish bhi laga rakhi hai locals ne. Aur so you can see that dish also. So it has actually been totally left to its own and just left to time and ignorance.
Actually, just to add, because Raja Saab moved to Pakistan and then later on he moved to the other European countries, and also then he went to Iraq.
Yeah.
What happened that his son stayed in India.
Exactly.
He lived in India and he didn't went to Pakistan. And this was a reason why they fight a legal battle, and that legal battle was partially won. And then again, it was upholded.
Exactly.
And it's still the family's heart.
It's still going on.
Not only this property, they have a huge properties all around, exactly. Because they were one of the richest talukdar at their times in the world.
Exactly.
And they have a lot of philanthropies also. In fact, Raja Saab was one of the founding members of Lucknow University. The biggest donations to the Lucknow University was given by Raja Saab. And also to the Aligarh University also, he have a lot of contributions.
Okay.
And family continued like this.
It is said that Gulabo Sitabo, the palace which has been shown, it also belongs to Raja Mahmudabad.
There is a huge amount of property of him lying around.
So even Umrao Jan was shot in Mahmudabad Palace.
And our friend Ali Bhai is one of the descendants from that family.
Yes.
Professor
Ali Khan Mahmudabad. Yes.
A book, Poetry of Belonging, that was one of the wonderful book written by him. So
yes.
can we come back to Kunal Bhai? So Kunal Bhai, going to the last of the visuals, then we will conclude with some of the questions from our friends. So what is this, Kunal Bhai? this photo is from, I think, Intact website, and you want to speak something about Harding Library, Delhi.
Not coming.
I can't see.
It's not coming, Rehan bhai.
Oh, one minute. Let me share the screen there. Sorry. Yes. Yeah. Is it visible now?
Yes. Go to full screen.
Yeah. Yeah. So this is roughly, I think, this is how I had seen Harding Library when I first came to Delhi, and it was nothing sort of a discovery for me. And मुझे लगा दिल्ली में near metro station and people don't talk about it, and it turned out this is actually under MCD, and you know, to talk about MCD and heritage is itself, you know, it's an alien concept. So I had to go somewhere else, and this was like a completely an act of discovery. So I decided to wander in, and at that point of time there was no mention of Harding Library anywhere because they've already changed the name. So I kept wandering around, and I could see it had a colonial design to it. So main andar pahuncha and I met the librarian also. But before doing that, while I was entering the porch, I saw a black marble plaque, and there it said Harding Library, you know, and it had the mention of the Maharaja of Kashmir, the Maharaja of Jaipur, and the Begum of Bhopal, you know, roughly around 70,000 rupees, or that point, 793 pound equivalent was endowed for the construction of this library. Now the story is so fascinating that this library was built, called of course back then Harding Library, and it was in the memory of Lord Harding, because on 23rd of December 1912, when during his state entry, when Lord Harding and Lady Harding, they were on their Howrahs, there was a bomb attack. You remember, it's called the Delhi Conspiracy.
Yes.
It's the infamous Delhi Conspiracy case. And there were people who were tried for it. And one of the person who was responsible for orchestrating the attack was Lala Hardayal. So this library in 1970 was renamed to Lala Hardayal Library. And the funny part is that Harding's H-A-R-D. So half the name actually is the same. Hardayal also has H-A-R-D. And both of them have exactly 8 letters. So when you rename the building, only have to rename the right half has to be renamed. This is a picture from, I think, about 1940s, I would say. But still, look at it, the grandeur of the library. I mean, you saw the picture roughly taken a couple of years ago. And this is exactly how it looked in 1916. I've even seen a picture of 1916 Harding Library when it was inaugurated. And this is one of the gates of, or rather one of the portions of library which is away from the main building, so the government do not know there's an English name Harding written there. So so I had found it long back. Of course, I could not locate my photo, so I took help of some gentlemen who had taken it. So I have actually dated the gentleman, Mr. Simon Trevite, and this is, you can still today, you can go there and find out this is still there. So this is,
and still, I think these jalis were added later on. I think these jalis were later on.
These are open.
Exactly.
So the interesting story is that when on 23rd December, when the attack happened, Lord Harding escaped with just a flesh attack, you know, just a minor flesh attack. So it was because he survived the attack, and Lady Harding went completely unscathed out. He came completely unscathed out of it. So in the memory of Lord Harding, they created this. And so it was made out of public subscription, you know, people and the Maharajas and all gave it. And instead of preserving it as for a posterity and telling them, you know, our own shallow patriotism, that they rename kar dete hain, which is not an isolated case. I mean, today I'm talking about isolated case in a very different way. You know, streets being renamed after Gandhiji, Queen Victoria statues being removed, and the parks being renamed. And actually, there's a small park in front of it. I think it's called the Queen's Park, which is now called Shaheed Yodha Udyan, something they call it. And there's actually a cannon inside it. You can go, and this cannon is still there. You can go and see it. So you can imagine the whole area must have been so beautiful at that point of time. So going to a library was an act of joy. Today it is an act of pain. It is an act of absolute mess that the whole city and that particular landmark is in. So, you know, that's how I conclude with the fifth one. And there are so many more, I would say, Rehan bhai, but you want to ask us to restrict to five, so we'll restrict to five.
And thank you, both of you, for this wonderful talk. Let's take some of the questions. It was Butler dream and struggle which made Lucknow the capital of the province. Thank you, Akshat Bhai, yes, for this add-on. Anis Bhai, yes, and Central Library is a magnificent colonial building. Let me see some other. These are the comments that have been received.
Okay.
Anand Mahal until recently was a government office. So there is Anis Bhai from Bijapur. Yeah, Bijapur, another historical corner, very important.
He's giving relevant examples from Bijapur.
Yes.
Bijapur
so Mahal, that's now a government building. Farak Mahal is also used as ACB office, and there is a lot of buildings that shown in Hyderabad also is having a same fate. This seems to be a British building. Yes, Mickey, this was a British building. Okay. Grab the attention. And so I think there is no question related to our talk. There are some inputs and engagements that people want to share the same thoughts. So Kunal Bhai and Ramin Bhai, thank you very, very much for this talk and sharing the stories and sharing your explorations. Any message both of you want to give a quick note before leaving?
My message will just be that we should move beyond the usual India gates and Taj Mahals and the red forts of the world. There are so many stories in India which we don't know about, which when we will come to know will blow our mind off. Our country has actually been an amalgamation of so many cultures, and Greeks, Turks, British, and except for the indigenous people, and they have left so many remnants of their life here, that if we just move beyond the usual, we will find a whole treasure trove waiting for us, and which will just open our mind about the beauty of our country. So that's
yes, of course. Kunal Bhai, something to add?
Yes, I have two very quick closing remarks. The very first is that, I and Ramin Bhai shared this rapport and mutual love is because, I have to thank my brother to connect with him. My brother was his senior at IIM Indore. And he told me, ki tum pagal ho, mere jaise, tumhare saa ek aur pagal mere college mein tha. Tum dono pagal ke saath rehte the. I am looking for pagal people. And he says, ki Ramin Bhai ke saath tum kyun nahi baat karte ho? He was so appreciative of him. And, he went to London and his entire concept of heritage changed. He would say, nahi, ye kya heritage mein rakha hua hai? What I'm saying is that charity begins at home, education begins at home. He used to argue with me, ki kya zarurat hai in building ko bachane ke liye, kya rakha hua hai cheezon mein. So when he went to London, he said, nahi, aap sahi baat keh rahe the. The way we should keep our heritage, it's like our living room, it's like our first impression of our country. How we keep our heritage, it also shows how sensitive we are, That's my number one point, that, upkeep of heritage should be our responsibility without prejudice. Ye colonial hai, Dutch hai, British hai, French hai, Portuguese hai. We should be proud of it. India has extraordinary range of it. Aap Goa chale jaiye, you get a Portuguese villa.
Exactly.
You go to Murshidabad, you get to Bankura. So there's this entire range across our country. We should be proud of it. Secondly, what I would like to say is that most people think in India is that हेरिटेज जो है एक बहुत बोरिंग सब्जेक्ट है जैसे रमीन भाई जो उसे बता भी रहे थे कि हमारा एजुकेशन जो सिस्टम है ना पीपल हैव बीन आवर चिल्ड्रन हैव बीन रेज्ड इन सच अ वे दैट वी थिंक दैट दिस सब्जेक्ट मैटर दैट वी टॉकिंग अबाउट इट ओनली कंसर्न्स द फ्यू पीपल अच्छा आप कुछ लोग आर्किटेक्ट हैं पीपल हैव मिस्टेकन मी फॉर एन आर्किटेक्ट पीपल हैव मिस्टेकन मी फॉर अ हिस्टोरियन एंड आई टेक इट एज अ बैकहैंडेड कॉम्प्लीमेंट दैट बट एट द सेम टाइम आई फील दैट आवर एजुकेशन सिस्टम शुड बी रिवैम्प्ड And children should be taken to the local monument, local historical places, not just to Bodh Gaya.
Exactly, there is a need to rebuild awareness or create awareness for every indigenous heritage, whether it's a monumental heritage, whether it's a cultural heritage or whatever form, there is a need to own it. Every heritage has its own significance from region to region. We have a huge range of diversity and we need to celebrate it rather than to fight on that. Or rather than to ignore on that aspect.
I call it in one phrase, I call it the pride and prejudice theory. That we should have pride in our heritage without any prejudice.
That's what we should be striving for. Exactly.
Feel completely proud of our heritage without any prejudice.
Thank you, friends, for joining in. So we are saying goodbye from here now, ending the broadcast.
Thank you.